Ian McElhinney, Sir Barristan Selmy, Game of Thrones. Yeah, it's been, it's actually the biggest, I think, that I've been to so far. You know, there's a lot of people already from very early on, and it's been very enjoyable. There's been a steady stream of people coming through, so happy with that. Three things probably helped. One is it was based on a very successful series of books, which were already out there and known to a lot of people, so it had a following before the show started. Second is the genre is hugely popular genre, so that genre always has a following. And the third thing is obviously the quality of the show itself. I mean, it's extraordinary cast, huge numbers in the cast, extraordinary number of storylines, which means it stays permanently interesting, extraordinary number of surprises, because George is very good at the unpredictable, so things you don't expect happen, and they can happen on quite a grand and graphic scale, which obviously helps to kind of promote the whole sort of excitement of the thing. And then the look of it, it looks fantastic. You know, the sets, the designs, the locations, the CGI, everything about it is incredibly impressive, and the detail and the attention to that detail is the most comprehensive that I've ever witnessed. So all those elements, of course, make it something a bit special, I think. Well, way back when, he was part of the Targaryen setup. He was actually the commander of the King's Guard to Aegon Targaryen. And as a proper commander of the King's Guard, he was dutiful. He did what was expected of him. He was noble. But unfortunately for him, he was serving a mad king. And in the battle that subsequently happened at the Trident, he survived and was actually pardoned by Robert Baratheon, and then became Robert Baratheon's commander of the King's Guard. That was fine. He liked Robert. Unfortunately, Robert wasn't. He was a great soldier, but he wasn't a great king. And Robert eventually died and was followed by the Lannisters, who are a despicable bunch, none of whom he liked. And at the point where he was offered retirement, he said, you know, it's not this for a game of soldiers, I'm out of here, and disappeared. And then returned, going back to his original roots, if you like, going back to the Targaryen clan. So he went in search of Daenerys, and now he's with Daenerys and commander of her Queen's Guard. And where he goes from here, we have to yet find out. Well, you know, the irony is, I know there's lots of wonderful actors in it. We actually work in very small pods. So, you know, I mean, there's loads of people in it whom I might know from other things, but who I've not met at all on this. There's loads who I've not met at all, period. And then there's a very small group of us who work together. And I must say, they're a great team. We all get on very well together. Emilia is an out-and-out star, I think, is Daenerys, you know. And we're having a great time doing it. And hopefully that will continue for a while yet. Oh, yeah, you're definitely going to get to see a lot more of that in season five, of her growth and development. But it's got to that interesting stage where I think at one point you might have thought, oh, well, she's nailed on to be the rightful ruler of Westeros. And perhaps she is. But we got to the stage where it's very hard to predict. And, I used to think absolutely categorically, you know, eventually Daenerys will get back there. Eventually Daenerys will win the throne and so on. My mind's completely open now. You know, anything can happen because, as I say, George doesn't do predictable. So who knows where we're going from here? I think everybody loves Tyrion because Tyrion is, I mean, he's witty, he's sharp. You kind of know his wit and his intellect will always kind of protect him no matter what situations he gets into. So, I mean, he's got a almost like a security blanket in that sense, if you like. Personally, I like Arya. I like that character. I like that journey. I have a soft spot for the whole Stark side of things, and I feel if there's any kind of justice in some way or another, the Starks will end up coming out of this well. I mean, the out-and-out sort of hero to start with was Ned Stark, and the most shocking thing in many ways was that the hero was killed off in series one. You kind of feel that if there's any kind of justice at some point, a Stark will emerge. But which one it is getting harder and harder to tell. I used to think I knew. I'm not sure anymore. Well, I feel it's very important to have the odd just character, the odd noble figure in it, which is where Barristan, I think, comes in. I mean, he is a character who I think has been essentially noble throughout and is one of the few of whom you could actually say that. So from my point of view, characters like him kind of need to survive or should survive to keep a sort of a proper balance between good and evil through the whole thing. You need some of your villains to continue because they provide a kind of a constant tug of excitement through it. So the odd villain will hang in there until the very end, I'm sure. But I would like to think that those who have a bit of nobility about them or who have grown into nobility, you know, might somehow or another end up sort of completing the circle, if you like. Yeah, I mean, for my character, I think, as I say, that he's important in Daenerys' setup because, first of all, she respects his age, she respects his knowledge, his history. He knows a lot more about her family than she does, and he's in many ways a source for that, for her. She knows that he will always try and do what he perceives to be the right thing. So I think in that sense, he's very important to her. And I like to believe, I can't predict, of course, I like to believe for that reason that he will be around to support her for the foreseeable future. Well, my favourite personal episode was whenever I stormed out of the Lannister court. I enjoyed doing that. I have a couple of lovely moments in season 5 coming up, which I won't go into, but for me, they're good moments. As far as the whole thing is concerned, I think probably the most powerful episode was probably the Red Wedding, because it's so shocking. The battle scenes are great, but what was particularly potent about the Red Wedding was that so many people with whom you'd identified, so many characters that you thought had a future, were suddenly just taken out of the equation, you know, so that was a very powerful episode. Well, you know, I mean, the show has lots of violence, lots of sex, and whether we agree with it or not, both sell and both excite people. And so those elements are going to be in there. Given the nature of the world, which is a pretty raw world, of course those elements are going to be in there. I accept that, you know, for some people it may all seem a bit too much, but I think for the majority of people it's just wildly exciting, and it certainly provokes their reaction because you're taking people out of the equation that they didn't expect to lose, you know, and there's always an element of how dare they be so, you know, unjust to remove X, Y, or Z, you know, but that's part of the fun of the piece, that nobody is that secure in this world, you know, it's a very, very dog-eat-dog sort of world, you know. Oh, the female characters are very strong in this. I mean, it's conceivable at the end of the day the female characters could well win out, you know. And yes, that is an unusual element of it, but that's one of the great things about it, that they're much more than just showpieces, if you like. They are there, they have power, they have wit, they have intelligence, they have agendas, they're not, you know, scared to pursue them, you know. So it's great to have that kind of strength in the women characters. I mean, the thing that always amazes me is that when you talk to most people who've watched the show, their bete noire was Joffrey. Yeah. And he is a despicable little character, but, you know. But Cersei is, you know, a hard one to stomach. It's possibly fair to say that she's actually less likable in the books than she is in the TV version. In the TV version, you know, I think by now you're beginning to develop some sympathy for the, you know, the whole Lannister clan, and Cersei is probably getting more sympathy than she had before. But she is a villain, and she's a good villain in that I think she'll be around for a while to plague us, but ultimately if there's any justice, she will get her comeuppance. Yeah, just keep watching. It's going to be even more unpredictable than before. I can guarantee, I won't give any spoilers, but I can guarantee there will be a lot of surprises in season 5.